Conduction is governed by Fourier's law. And Fourier's law says that the heat flux Q prime is proportional to a delta T divided by delta X. So graphically, what that means is that if we have heat flowing through a slab, so that's the Q flowing from left to right, it's going to be proportional to the difference between the hot temperature and the cold temperature on either sides. It's going to be inversely proportional to the thickness of the slab. So the greater the thickness of the slab, the less the heat flow. But it also says that Q is a Q prime. So that is a heat flow per area that we are flowing through. If we now rewrite this Fourier's law and include a proportionality constant, we can write that Q is equal to minus K delta T delta X, where this K is the thermal conductivity, sorry for the spelling, so that's the thermal conductivity. We can then write that more correctly mathematically, so that's Q prime, so Q prime is now equal to minus K delta T delta X. And then if we want to have this instead of a flux, we can simply have it as a Q. So Q would then become minus Ka dT dx. Writing this more mathematically correct, we now have that the Q dot is equal to minus Ka dT dx. Q is going to be in units of joules per second, so that's why we have the dot on the Q, or more commonly written in watts. K, we said, was going to be the thermal conductivity, and the units of that are going to be in watts per meters Kelvin. The area, importantly here, the area is the area that is perpendicular to the flow of heat. That area is in meters squared. T, the delta T, we are going to have T hot on the left in this diagram, minus the temperature cold, or from T hot to cold rather, is in kelvins, and X is the thickness of the slab, and that will be in meters. So there are some assumptions that we quickly need to make on this that we often have. The first one is that the hot temperature, T hot, is the same across all of the area, so that's all of A. So the entire section of the area has the same heat transfer. So what that'll mean is that we only have hot flowing in this diagram from left to right and not in three dimensions because of different temperature gradient across the wall. The next one is that we are going to be using the area perpendicular to the flow of heat. And just to confirm, X is the direction through that slab, from left to right. So if we are trying to solve this now for Q is equal to minus Ka dT dx, you will notice, I hope, that this equation is a separable differential equation. So the first step we want to do is we are going to put the dx on the left-hand side, and we're going to leave the dT on the right. The Q we will leave on the left-hand side for the moment. The K and the A, we need to determine whether they are functions of temperature or X. There are going to be circumstances where the K is going to be a function of temperature, capital T, and the area is going to be a function of X. If they are a function of T or X, we need to put them on the same side as the T and the X as we have them in the equation at the bottom for now. If they are constants and they are not a function of temperature or area, this becomes a simple equation of separating these out. And most commonly, you'll see the form of K and A on the left-hand side, so it's minus Ka underneath the Q, multiplied by dx is equal to dt. There are no functions of X and T, so we can simply integrate for X is equal to naught, to X is equal to L, being the length of the slab, just as an example here. And we're going to integrate at the bottom from temperature hot to temperature cold. If we then simplify this equation mathematically, we can then integrate and we'll have q over minus ka on the left multiplied by l minus 0 because there is no function of x inside the integral. So it's l minus 0 is equal to temperature cold minus temperature hot. So we went from length minus naught, so we're going from t cold minus t hot. A simple step now, we have got a negative Ka on the left. We're going to use that negative to have T hot minus T cold so that we get a positive value in this. We are then going to leave it as Q on the left. So we'll have Q, and I've missed out my dot here. So Q will stay on the left. On the right, we're going to swap T hot and T cold. So that gets rid of this negative sign on the left. We're going to take the Ka back onto the left-hand side, and we'll divide by L. So in a neater form, Q is equal to Ka T hot minus T cold divided by L. If we had to look at a system of two slabs, so we might have a wall and an insulation layer, we are going to again start with Q is equal to minus Ka dT dx. However, we're now going to look at each wall individually. So for slab 1, and I will call it Q1, so Q1 will equal K1 area 1 T hot minus T1 divided by length 1. So that's using the same approach as we did before. The second wall would now be Q2 is equal to K2 area 2 temperature 1 minus temperature cold. So that's still a hot minus a cold, but it's temperature 1 minus temperature cold divided by length 2. Now it's important to have a look and see what terms are the same and what are different. At this stage we only have two equations, and can we solve this because there are only two unknowns? First of all, we have two different Qs. If this is at steady state, these Qs are in fact the same. So Q1 is actually equal to Q2 if this is at steady state. And for all the examples we are going to do in this course, they will be the same. The next one is area 1 and area 2. So in this picture, as we can see here, the two slabs are the same size. So area 1 is actually the same as area 2 as well. So area 1s and area 2s I'm going to rewrite as a simple A. In this example, K1 and K2 are different because there's an insulation layer, so they are not going to be the same. The next thing I want to highlight is which of these terms are you typically given and which are you not given. The temperature hot is fairly easy to find. That will be with a thermometer, a thermostat, a thermocouple. You can find that temperature as well as the T cold. So most of the time in your questions, you will be given a T hot and a T cold. As a good engineer, you should know that K1 and K2, you can go and look up in textbooks. So those thermal conductivities you can find. Length 1 and length 2, you will almost always be given, or you can hopefully measure off plans or something like that. So the two that we are left with as unknowns are now going to be, the only two unknowns is going to be Q. So what is Q? And we already said that they're the same. And what is temperature 1? If we have two equations and two unknowns, we can actually solve this now. So the question is, what is the quick and easy way to do this? So we originally had Q is equal to K1A T hot minus T1 divided by L. I'm going to suggest that you rewrite that as the temperature hot minus the temperature 1, so it's still temperature hot minus cold, is equal to Q length 1 divided by K1A. So I'm simply rewriting that form of the equation in this fashion. The same thing, the equation that we've got for the second slab, I will rewrite that to be temperature 1, so that's the hot minus temperature cold is equal to Q L2 divided by K2A. So if we've got these two equations, so it's two equations, two unknowns, we should be able to solve. The simplest way to do that is going to be to add the equations. And if you have a quick look, if we add the equations, you'll see that temperature 1 falls away because there's a negative on the top and a positive at the bottom. And we can then have on the left-hand side simply that T hot minus T cold is equal to whatever's on the right. And on the right, it is Q L1 on K1A plus, because we're adding them, Q L2 divided by K2A. Or more commonly, this is going to be written as the difference in temperature is equal to Q divided by A, because those are common terms in both of these side, sorry, both these terms on the right hand side, multiplied by L1 on K1 plus L2 on K2. We've now got a single equation where we said previously that the unknown is going to be most likely the Q with all the others unknown. So that means we can solve that equation for Q. If you then want to find a temperature, we simply need to go back up to the top here and either one of the first or the second equation that we had for temperature hot minus temperature 1 and temperature 1 minus temperature cold, you can then use either one of those to solve for the temperature 1. So this concept can now be extended to as many slabs in series as you want. So we now have n slabs in series, where slab 1, 2, and 3 are again written as Q is equal to K1A T hot minus T cold on the length, or the nth slab with Ln. In exactly the same way, we can add all of these equations together to get the simple term T hot minus T cold is equal to Q on A plus the L1 on K1 terms. It is, however, more common to write this in this next form of T hot minus T cold is equal to Q multiplied by L1 divided by K1A terms, so each of these in the bracket. And the reason for that is that we can now write this in a simplified form of Q is equal to delta T divided by the sum for I is equal to 1 to N for the Li, Ki, A terms. And that term on the bottom is more commonly written as R, where R is a thermal resistance.